Today, I am going to tell you about the 10 best techniques used to hack and crack passwords. But hey, password hacking and cracking are completely different things. You would have seen other videos about password cracking where they list the same common techniques like brute force, rainbow tables, and phishing mixed with each other. Well, those techniques may be commonly used, but it completely neglects the meaning of hacking and cracking. I actually researched a lot, but most of the videos and articles repeat the same thing again and again. While password hacking includes techniques like password spraying and phishing attacks, password cracking includes Markov chains and rainbow tables. So in this video, I will explain what both password hacking and cracking are, how are they different, and how they work. Then I will list 5 techniques which can be used to acquire passwords in plain and readable form through hacking, and 5 techniques used to crack password if someone manages to get hashed or encrypted version of the password. This video has everything. And believe me, this will probably be the last video you'll need on this topic. I mean, you may want to learn about more methods and techniques, but after this video, you'll know what you want to find and how to find. But I highly recommend to not skip the explanation part. If you just want to know about the techniques, then that's fine, but at least listen to the first few seconds of the explanation part. It's not that long, so I really recommend you should complete it without skipping, but if you want to, then watch a few seconds, then decide. So without wasting more time, let's begin. Password hacking is the process where hackers attempt to get unauthorized access to someone's password of a system, account, or device. For that, there are various methods they can use, like SQL injection, password spraying, etc., etc. The purpose here is to somehow extract the password from either the server, the system, or the target person. But hey, password is not stored in plain text. Even if a hacker somehow manages to get access to the database or just extract it using some hacking methods, that's still not enough because almost every website on the internet store their user's password by hashing or encrypting it using a secret key. And here's where cracking comes in. But before cracking, let's understand more about this. Technically, if the password is encrypted, you have to find out the encryption algorithm and the secret key which was used to encrypt that password. If you become successful to do that, you can reverse that encrypted password to original form. But encryption is used in very few websites for storing passwords. Most of the time, companies hash the password. While encryption was a two-way function and we can decrypt it to convert it to original form, hashing is not reversible. When you put a password through a hashing algorithm, it generates a random string. And there is no way to reverse this string into the original form, but it's unique. Even if it looks random, this string is the only possible string with this combination, and hashes have no similarity or patterns. And whenever you hash that password again, using same algorithm from any device in the universe, the result will be same as well. This is stored in the database, and even the owner of the website can't decrypt this. When the user logs in, the provided password is hashed and then matched with the hash in the database. If it matches, then that means the password is correct. But if it doesn't, it's incorrect. I will tell you how it is cracked later in this video, but there is a big twist that now comes in. Hashing may be hard, but there are some chances it can be cracked, but the new twist makes it 1,000 times more secure and almost impossible to crack. It is called salting, or salt. Salting is the process of adding random data into the input and then hashing that mixed input. This random data is the salt, and every password is hashed with completely unique salt. This way, even if two users have the same password, their hashes will be different. Many websites like Google and Facebook use this method. This makes it impossible to crack it using rainbow tables because there is no way it knows the extra salt used in the hash. Online brute force is a possible option, but it's common sense that if a website uses such a secure method to store passwords, of course it has brute force protection too. So now that you have understood that, I am now going to list 5 techniques which hackers can use to hack passwords in plain and readable form, because that's the best and efficient way to get passwords in this world of increasing security. And then I'm going to list 5 techniques which is used to crack passwords. If hackers somehow get hashed and encrypted passwords, there are some new techniques in the cracking section about which you may not have even heard before, so don't skip anything. The ranking of these methods are random and not according to their effectiveness. And of course, everything I am talking about is just to explain things required as an ethical hacker. This is not meant for harm, and no harm can be done just by listening to popular techniques. It's just valuable and publicly available information, and you can save yourself from these kind of attacks if you know how it works. With that, let's start with the hacking technique number 1. Password spraying. Password spraying is an attack where the attacker uses a single word list with commonly used passwords or passwords with patterns against a large number of accounts. This attack is similar to brute force but is more effective because instead of trying on each account, they are brute forcing many accounts at once within equal amount of time. This is usually performed when a hacker wants to get access into an organization, office, etc. And for that, they have to get into one of the employees' account. In a large amount of people, there is a high chance that someone has a commonly used password in their account, which can be hacked using the word list. It avoids triggering automated account lockout mechanisms that would typically be triggered by multiple failed login attempts for a single account, because the attacker makes a few attempts per account, reducing the risk of detection. Man-in-the-middle attack. Man-in-the-middle is an attack where the hacker intercepts the data being communicated between your device and the internet. They can see it, manipulate it, and of course, steal it. Now, man-in-the-middle is not a single attack. It's a collection of multiple attacks like sniffing, session hijacking, DNS spoofing, etc., which can be done on a person using the same network as yours. Whenever we use websites and forms, get or post requests are sent to the server of the website, and in response to the request, the website provides us the content. If we log in, our credentials will also be sent through these requests. And through sniffing, the hacker sitting on your network can intercept it and see everything. Now, this only works for HTTP websites, and most of the websites use HTTPS, but that's not a big deal for a pro hacker. An attack called SSL stripping can be used to downgrade the connection to HTTP. 99% of the requests will have the credentials in plain text from where hackers can steal it. But if, for any reason, the website hashes on the client side, hackers can use DNS spoofing to replace the original website with their cloned version, and then transfer the credentials typed by the target to their device. Man in the middle is one of the best and effective hacking techniques, but another way to grab target's password in plain and readable form is social engineering. Now, I don't have to explain a lot about this because you may already know a lot, but similar to man in the middle attack, social engineering is also a collection of multiple amazing attacks. The main point of social engineering is to manipulate the target into giving some sensitive information. For that, hackers can use different methods like impersonation, in which they pretend to be someone else, such as a coworker, IT technician, or customer service representative, to manipulate individuals into providing access to systems or sensitive information. Phishing, in which hackers send deceptive emails, messages, websites that mimics original one and tricks the target into putting their sensitive information such as passwords, credit card numbers, or personal information. Pretexting is a technique where hacker creates a fabricated scenario to gain the trust of individuals. For example, someone calls you and says that your payment card is getting denied due to some problems and they can help you solve it. These attackers first gather information about you before planning the attack, and they know that your payment is actually getting denied. Most of the victims fall for it. Baiting is an attack where the attackers lure their victims by offering free downloads or prizes, and to receive it, the target needs to provide some information. This may sound absurd, but many people actually fall for it. But social engineering is not limited to online attacks. If you want, then I can create a dedicated video on everything about social engineering. But the techniques I listed earlier are the most used online social engineering attacks. And passwords are the most popular things that get stolen in these attacks. But another way to hack passwords other than social engineering is malware. Malware is actually a great technique. If hackers are able to make someone install a malware or Trojan on their device by any means possible, that can give them control over a lot of things. I have made a video on an undetectable Trojan, which does not steal anything, but sure, crashes the target's computer. So you can watch it later after this video. Link is in the description. But when focusing on password hacking, there are two type of malware that are the best. First is keylogger, which if installed on a device, captures everything typed by the person on that device and sends all of that information to the hacker. You don't necessarily have to install it on the target's device. If the target is someone who sometimes uses your device, you can install keylogger on your own device, then give it to them to use it. It will capture everything. Keyloggers are not only apps and softwares. There are physical keyloggers as well, which can be plugged into a PC and capture all of the keystrokes. Another malware that can be used is spyware. It's similar to keyloggers, but instead of just capturing keystrokes, it captures everything. But it's more detectable than keyloggers. Finally, we have cookie theft on number 5. Now, this is not a password hacking technique. When you log into a website, it stores a cookie on your device, which helps that website to recognize you and automatically log you into your account next time you visit that website. This is stored on your device. And if someone steals this cookie, they can use it to log into your account without knowing the password or even username. Now, to steal cookies, hackers need either physical or online access of the target's device, and it's hard but definitely possible. If someone is desperate to get your password, they can definitely plan it and make it possible. It can be done by either using multiple methods together with each other or using devices like Rubber Ducky to automate the process of stealing cookies. The five techniques I listed earlier are very effective, and if someone knows how to properly use this, they can gain access to people's account without needing to later waste time on cracking hashed and encrypted passwords with 50-50 chances of being successful. But if they somehow got their hands on the hashed or encrypted passwords, they need to crack it. And I am going to tell you how it's done. But before that, how can you learn the techniques I listed earlier? I tried uploading a decent SQL injection tutorial a few weeks ago, but it got strike even if I censored almost everything. And the target website was a dummy website, which was legal to perform attacks on. So I don't think it's possible to do it on YouTube. So what I want you to do is subscribe this channel and keep yourself updated. I am currently designing a new website, which I will try to release soon. On that website's learning section, there will be a page for hacking where I will upload tutorial for every hacking attack I talk about in this channel. Not only this channel, but almost every techniques that I know or am going to know about. No theory, no time waste. Just full-on hacking tutorial for everyone who wants to learn them or keep them secure from it. There will be folders divided for every type of attack like website hacking, Wi-Fi hacking, etc. And those folders will have all kinds of attacks related to it. Hundreds or probably thousands of attacks at one place. I will add new tutorials continuously and update the attacks that are outdated. So if you want that, join my channel by subscribing and help me earn some money to hire editors. Anyway, now let's see what are the five ways used to crack password effectively. The first is, of course, Rainbow Table. Many of you already know what it is, so I am not gonna take a long time here. Just listen. Rainbow Table is a pre-computed table that contains the hash values of billions of words and passwords. It's like a big cheat sheet of hashes. If a hacker has a hash value, they can run it through a Rainbow Table. If it's an easy password, it will be cracked in no time. What if it's a hard password? Well, if that kind of password has ever been breached somewhere, it's more likely that it'll be cracked by the Rainbow Table. But if it's a complete monster of a password, they have to depend on chances. Hashing is a one-way function. It's impossible to reverse it. Password cracking is all about the target and luck. But they can increase the efficiency of password cracking process to increase the chances of success. For that, they can use probabilistic context-free grammar. No, I am not teaching you grammar. It's actually a technique in which hackers use a statical model to generate passwords based on patterns observed in a given set of passwords. It's like a smart system that learns from lots of passwords. It figures out common patterns people use, like using words, numbers, or special characters in certain ways. Hackers can train it using the content from the social media accounts of the target whose password they are trying to find. Instead of blindly guessing, it uses these patterns and available information to make educated guesses that has more chances of working. There is one more technique similar to this called Markov chains. It's similar but different. With a Markov chain, you're still using patterns, but it's more about the sequence of characters. It looks at the probability of each character appearing after the previous one based on a set of observed passwords. For example, if T often comes after A in passwords, the Markov chain will take that into account when guessing. It's like predicting the next character in a password based on what came before it. But hey, these were for guessing possible password. How is it password cracking? Yeah, this technique is used to create word lists containing a large number of possible passwords. And since this word list is made by training these models with the data of the target and real life patterns and structures of passwords, this word list will have the highest chances of success than any word list in the world. It will make password cracking highly effective if used together with an attack called brute force. Again, you'll wonder, brute force is a hacking attack, right? Yeah, it is. It's used for both hacking and cracking. Brute force is an attack where hackers use an automated script to continuously try thousands of password combinations until the correct one is found. When they do this on an online login form, it's hacking. But if they do it offline by targeting a hash value, like we do in Wi-Fi hacking using aircrack NG, it's cracking. They can't run this attack on login forms because most of the websites now use brute force protections and they can't make more than 3 or 5 attempts. That's why I listed this in cracking section. What they need here is the hash they are trying to crack and the algorithm that was used to hash that password. Don't worry, most of the websites disclose what algorithms they use because that doesn't really matter. Once they have both of these, they can create a word list of passwords using techniques like CEWL, Markov chains, or PCFG, as I told earlier, and then write a script that hashes each password in the word list using the algorithm specified and matches it with the original hash. If not matching, try next one. And if matched, print the password. Since this is offline and on personal device, it will be much faster. This kind of attack is probably the most effective version of brute force. but it'll not work if salt was used in the original hash. If the hacker used SQL injection to extract the hash password, they also have to extract the salt, which should be stored in one of the columns of the row containing the ID and the hash password. The next cracking technique is pass the hash. This is not for cracking passwords of accounts on websites. If we are talking about cracking, I thought I should include some system password cracking too. Pass the hash is a technique which takes advantage of the way authentication protocols work in Windows systems. Instead of cracking the hashes to reveal the actual plaintext passwords, the attacker can simply use the hash itself for authentication. It sounds strange, but it actually works in Windows' new technology LAN manager. This technique can also be used on websites if it hashes the password on the client side and then sends the hash to the server to match with the original one, but I don't think normal websites do that. So the main usage of this attack is on Windows systems. The last technique is John the Ripper. Yeah, it's a tool, but due to its popularity, whenever hackers need to crack passwords, it automatically comes to mind. It's an open source tool used in various types of password cracking. It can crack hashes as well as password protected zip files, encrypted PDFs, SSH keys, and can perform various attacks like hybrid attacks, mask attack, rainbow table attack, and etc. It supports a wide range of algorithms, including MD5, SHA-1, SHA-256, and many others. Take it as an all-in-one password cracking toolkit. It's easy to use and very popular. Of course it's a legal tool, but misusing a tool for malicious purpose is a crime, and by doing this, you can go to jail. So practice safe learning and understand how these techniques work so you can develop your skills if you are an ethical hacker and save yourself and others if you are a normal internet user. Now, since you have learned about password hacking techniques, why not watch the video on the right side to learn what are the 10 ways to hack websites and its users? I am planning to make my next video on top 5 password hacking tools. If you have a better idea, comment down. I always read comments and try to react. So if your idea sounds good, video will be uploaded on Sunday. Thanks for watching. See you soon.